There are many causes of menstrual irregularities. Some of them being pelvic inflammatory disease, pregnancy very common, and changes in hormonal balance, stress, anxiety, and hypo or hyperthyroidism, but the most common being PCOS, that is polycystic ovarian syndrome, and that happens to be the topic of discussion for today. So hello everyone, this is Dr. Maha Wakarbek, your very own, and you guys are watching Versatile Dr. Maha. So before we start with the video, same old reminder to all of you, don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Do it right now because then you'll guys forget. And hit the bell icon so that every time I post a new video, you get a notification. So today's topic is going to be very interesting. So I would request you all to stay till the end of the video, because at the end I'm going to tell about the management of PCOS, which is the most important thing. And a lot of girls and women are looking for those answers, which I'm going to give at the end of the video. So stay tuned with me and share this video as much as possible. So let's start. What exactly is polycystic ovarian syndrome? Like the word says, polycystic. Poly means multiple, or many, cystic means cyst. So presence of multiple cysts in the ovary causes polycystic ovary. Now let's start with pathophysiology. We'll discuss it in very short because it's not very important for it's more important for medical professionals. So number one is theca cell hypertrophy, which will result in increase in testosterone level in a female. And second is defective aromatization in the ovary, which will cause decrease in estradiol, and again normal aromatization in periphery, which will cause increase in estrone. So basically, in short, if I'd like to say, it will cause hormonal imbalance in the body of a female. So hormonal imbalance, which is very important, and it causes again irregular menstruation and things which we'll come on to that later on. Now let's come on to the risk factors. Risk factors, number one, we have a genetic predisposition. Genetic predisposition usually seen in first degree relatives or in monozygotic twins. Then second, we come on to environmental factors. Environmental factors play a huge role in causing PCOS, because we all know, like, few decades before we did not have this disease, and now it's becoming so common. And now coming on to number three is obesity, that is prepubertal obesity, which will again result in PCOS. Now let's come on to number four, that is early onset of menarche. This also seems to play a role in causing PCOS. And again, last point, valproic acid use. Some patients who are using valproic acid as a drug, seizures or any case, so they also seem to develop PCOS later on as a side effect. So that was about risk factors. Now let's come on to the clinical features. What are the clinical features of PCOS? What are the symptoms? How will you guys come to know as to you have PCOS or not? So the symptoms are, firstly, the most common symptom is irregular menstruation. If a woman has irregular menstruation, then she should not sit back at home and she should think, okay, now I've missed my period, and what could it be, what could not be? Because usually girls, when they are young, they are kind of shy and they think, okay, they are not very familiar that what's going on. So you should not sit back at home, and you should go to your gynecologist and tell her that you're having an irregular menstruation, or you've skipped a period or whatever. So irregular menstruation is number one. Then you have hyperandrogenism. Now what hyperandrogenism means? Androgen. What exactly is androgen? Androgens are male hormones. And hyper means increase in number. So hyperandrogenism means increase in male hormones in the body of a female. So what happens in hyperandrogenism? The woman may have acne vulgaris, acne all over the face, right? Acne vulgaris. Then they would have hirsutism. What is hirsutism? Hirsutism means facial hair. And then the third point is hair loss. So women can go through hair loss. So that was about hyperandrogenism. Now let's come on to the third symptom, that is polycystic ovary. Like I said, polycystic ovary, you can see the presence of cysts in ovary, and that is detected on ultrasound. So you can see there's a string of pearls, like we say in our medical terms, string of pearl appearance. Fourth point is obesity. So like I said it before, it is also a risk factor, prepubertal obesity. If a woman develops PCOS, then majority of women develop obesity or they become overweight. But that is not the case in all of the women. So let me tell you that also. Okay, so that was about the clinical features. Now let's talk about comorbidities associated or the complications. So in patients of PCOS, insulin resistance is seen very commonly, and that might lead to diabetes mellitus. So number one becomes diabetes mellitus. Then we have endometrial hyperplasia. Endometrial hyperplasia means the uterine lining, the lining of the uterus, that is the endometrium, that becomes thickened. That means hyperplasia. Endometrial hyperplasia, that is number two, and which will further lead to number three, endometrial cancer. And apart from that, because of insulin resistance, there's hyperlipidemia, and hyperlipidemia can result in syndrome X, which is a metabolic syndrome. Then they can also have cardiovascular diseases, which is again because of the hyperlipidemia. And ovarian cancer, they can have ovarian cancer, but that is rare. And osteoporosis can also be seen, but that is rare again. And these women, they go through depression, anxiety, because then what happens, they start to dislike their body, because overweight and hirsutism and acne. So, and again, if they are aged female and who are trying to have a baby, who are trying to conceive, then again depression for that as well. So depression, anxiety, a strongly associated complication and comorbidity of PCOS. So that was about the complications. Now let's talk about the diagnostic criteria. How will a doctor know that a person has PCOS? So now, what exactly is Rotterdam criteria? Basically, Rotterdam criteria has three criteria, and if you have any two of the three or more than two, then of course the person will have PCOS. So the first criteria is menstrual irregularities, that is either oligomenorrhea or amenorrhea. Number two, we have hyperandrogenism. Like I said before, what exactly is hyperandrogenism? And number three, we have presence of cysts in the ovary. So if the person has two or more than two of these criteria, then the person definitely has polycystic ovary syndrome. And let me tell you guys here that obesity is not a criteria for diagnosing the PCOS. So now let's come on to the most important part, and that is management of PCOS. So let me tell you guys that if you are very serious about eliminating PCOS from your life, you will have to follow strict, and I repeat, strict lifestyle modification. The drugs can help you. If you want to lead a healthy life, then all you need to do is change your lifestyle. And when I say change your lifestyle, I mean strict changes in your lifestyle. So number one, lifestyle modification. What changes to bring in your lifestyle, I'll just discuss it shortly. So in the pharmacological treatment aspect, we are going to divide our treatment for those who do not want to conceive and for those who do want to conceive. So treatment option for those who do not want to conceive, again, I am not going to tell you the drugs which are going to be used. I am not going to tell that online. You will have to visit your gynecologist for that and discuss it in person. Because let's face it, every woman who is suffering from PCOS is not same as the other woman who is suffering from PCOS. One drug which benefits person A will not benefit person B, right? So I would just give some broad terms, like if you have to regularize the cycle, there's a different drug to regularize the cycle, like contraceptive drugs. But again, different drugs are there. I won't be naming them right now. And then again, because of diabetes mellitus, potential diabetes mellitus, insulin sensitizers have to be given. Then again, treatment for hirsutism, acne has to be given. So that was about women who do not want to conceive. And for women who do want to conceive, firstly, lifestyle modification, which I'll just discuss in detail. After lifestyle modification, it's very important to talk about pregnancy. These women will have to be very attentive and very cautious about their pregnancy. They just cannot have random pregnancy. They'll have to have protected intercourse so that they could avoid any unplanned pregnancy. So these patients who have PCOS, they'll have to have a planned pregnancy, because any unplanned pregnancy will result, most of the times it results in miscarriages, and then that is not a good day for anyone. So go visit your gynecologist, sit with the gynecologist, and then plan your pregnancy, and then your treatment for infertility will start, and that's when the pregnancy will be planned. And it is, because it's a very like we say, it's a precious pregnancy, so it requires a lot of care and a lot of treatment and planning. So that was about the treatment part, pharmacologic treatment. Now let's talk about lifestyle modification. Now firstly, let's start with the diet. Food is very important, because our lifestyle right now, all of us are so fond of junk food. We all love to have pizzas, burgers, and processed foods. You know, we have packaged, love having packaged foods, chips, chocolates, etc. So I'm sorry to say, but if you are serious enough for treating your PCOS, you'll have to say a big no to all of the junk food. Big no to junk food, then low carbohydrate diet. Because like I said before, because there's insulin resistance in our body, so we'll have to have a low carbohydrate diet. So your plate should be full of vegetables, fresh vegetables and pulses, and increase your intake of fruits. Lots of fruits, vegetables. If you'll increase this in your diet, then of course you'll see a huge difference, especially in your weight gain. So you'll have to reduce your weight. Coming on to weight reduction, now let's come on to point number two, exercise. Take out 15 to 30 minutes of your life and devote that time to treating your PCOS. Workout, exercise, but not a very strenuous workout. Do not stress yourself. You can have yoga. Yoga has seemed to be very beneficial, and like I said in my previous videos as well, yoga is a big yes from my side. So if you reduce your weight by 10%, then that is a great deal of work done by you on your part, and that will help a lot. So keep in mind that you have to reduce around 10% of your body weight. So exercise is an essential part of your lifestyle change. Now let's come on to the third point, is having a nice sound sleep. Our sleep pattern has gone so haywire in the past few years because of the, you know, mobile use and internet and Netflix. So for having a good night's sleep, what I personally do is, and I would recommend you guys as well, every time I go to sleep, I turn off my internet and turn off the notifications as well. So that only important calls will only wake me up and nothing else. Because sometimes what happens is you're sleeping and you're having notifications and messages from Facebook and Instagram, and then you tend to wake up. So stop that, turn off your internet, mobile data, and then go off to sleep. So have a nice sound sleep, which will help a lot again in your lifestyle changes. That was the change, that is the third part. Now let's come on to the fourth part. Relax and meditate again, because meditation is really important. Because like I said, these women, they tend to go through anxiety and depression. So meditation, yoga will again help you calm yourself, and you know, you'll feel relief and you'll not have depression and anxiety anymore. So there's a lot of study has been done that using plastic causes a bad effect on your health, and plastic is really not good. So replace all your plastic utensils and plastic water bottles with those of stainless steel or glass. So that again will help your body and help your health. So that was all the lifestyle changes which you'll have to make, and you'll have to seriously commit to them, because this is the only way you'll be able to feel good about your body and you'll be able to have regular menstruation. Because I've had friends, I've known people who have followed this diet plan, this exercise, sleep and everything, and they are having normal menstruation now. So medicines alone will not be able to affect you guys. Medicines will, along with lifestyle modification, will help you. And especially like I said before, if a woman wants to conceive or have a baby, then again, firstly lifestyle modification, and then planned pregnancy, which is discussed with the gynecologist. And if you guys follow all this, especially if you guys change your lifestyle and have a great lifestyle modification, then you'll see the results, and I'm pretty sure that you'll be happy. So guys, that was it from my side. I hope that you guys liked the video, and if you did, then give a big thumbs up to this video and share this as much as possible. And if you have any queries, then please do ask me in the comment section. And if there's a part where you want me to make a separate video on any problem, then I'm gonna do that as well. So that's it guys. Take care you guys. Bye bye.